Bless the Lord. Glory to God. Greetings. Greetings in the most precious anointed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is great to be in the house of the Lord. I am determined to hold on to the end. Are you determined to hold on to the end? Do you want to make it to the end? The Bible tells us that the person who endures to the end is the same that is going to be saved. It tells us that the race is not for the swift, nor the battle for the strong, but it is those who endure to the end. If you want to receive your reward from Yeshua, you have to go to the end. We have to run to the end. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. None of those 100-meter runners never receive any prize until they make it to the end. You got to go to the end. You can't stop in the middle of the race. Praise the name of the Lord. Our desire, our determination is to make it to the end. I greet everyone today in the most precious anointed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to welcome everyone today to Straight Gate Ministries. It is good to be here. In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And at His right hand, He has pledges forevermore. Today, we are going to continue in our study of the book of Luke. We continue our verse-by-verse study of the book of Luke. And today, we find ourselves in chapter 17. Chapter 17 of the book of Luke. You need your Bible. You've got to follow along your Bible. You're not going to understand a lot if you're not looking into your Bible. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Amen. We need to become hungry and thirsty for the Word of God. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusted in Him. Are you tasting? Are you drinking from the fountain? Amen. Is the Emmanuel, God with us? Is He welling up in you today? Glory be to God. He that drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But he that drinketh of the water I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water shall be in him as a well of water springing up unto everlasting life. Do you have a spring in you today? Is Yeshua springing up in you? Is Yeshua welling up in you today? Oh, glory be to God. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We give honor and praise to the Most High for allowing us to be here again in the presence of the Lord. And we are going to pick up in the book of Luke today in verse 11 of the book of Luke. We bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great privilege that we can come together in the house of the Lord and we can encourage our brothers and our sisters. Lord, we thank you because you renew our strength. Hallelujah. You renew our strength like the eagle. And Lord, even as we open up Holy Scriptures another time, pray that the anointing of God, the burden removing yoke destroying power of God will come upon us as we look into the Word of God today. I pray for the skills and the ability, the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding to rightly divide the Word of God to your people. Bless us in Jesus' precious, wonderful name. All right, we're going to do a few verses today in Luke chapter 17, and we'll pick up from verse 11. And it tells us, and it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Now, as we discussed before, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, and he's going up to Jerusalem, and he's on a mission. His mission is that he's going to die. Jesus is heading to die on the cross of Calvary in Jerusalem. Boy, he is going from village to village. As we discussed before, he's going from one village to the next, and he's teaching the people. He's preaching the last message to these villages that he was passing through. And it tells us it came to pass as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Now he's going through Samaria, he's going through Galilee, and you have to understand that in that time, the nation of Israel, they had three provinces, and one was Judea, and one was Samaria, and Galilee. And Jesus was going and he was heading up to Jerusalem. Jerusalem was located in Judea. So what he's doing here, he's passing through these two provinces, which is Samaria and Galilee. And Samaria is where the half-breed people were living, where the people that was rejected. And we will get into that later on. We'll talk about that, the Samaritans. And we will get into a little bit of history about the Samaritans later on. But here we see he's going through also Galilee. Now, in parts of the New Testament, Galilee was referred to as Galilee of the Gentiles. And Galilee, it was where the Gentiles was living. And most of the Gentiles was living in Galilee. And we have to understand who is the Gentiles. In Genesis chapter 10, we study in Genesis chapter 10 that the Gentiles people, according to the Bible, are from the line of Japheth. And it is referring to people from Europe. And it's talking about Europeans. When you talk about Gentiles, you are talking about Europeans, according to the Bible. And not according to the church. The church tells us that we are Gentiles. Anybody ever hear that? You ever hear that doctrine in the church? That we are the Gentiles. And the people who live in the land of Israel, they are the chosen people of God. They are the Jewish people of God, and they are chosen. And we are Gentiles. And according to what the scripture is telling us, we have to go according to the Bible. And that's the reason why I was saying this morning that a lot of the history that we know and the history that we read and some of these theology books that we read and some of these Bible commentaries that we read and tell us that we are the Gentiles and all of these things. A lot of these books need to be thrown out. And a lot of these things need to be rewritten. And the Bible tells us here who the Gentiles are. And when it talks about Galilee of the Gentiles, it is referring to the Romans. The Romans at that time, they were controlling the nation of Israel. And the Roman garrison, the Roman army, they have a garrison that was set up in Galilee. And that's the reason why they call it Galilee of the Gentiles. You remember when Jesus was selecting his disciples, and I think it was Philip, when Philip met Nathanael, and he asked, he gave Nathanael the good news, and invited him to come and meet with Jesus. And Nathanael asked the question, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Nazareth was a village within Galilee, and those places was considered to be no good because of the fact that the Gentiles, referring to the Romans was living, or the Romans had their garrison, their army camp was set up in Galilee. And you all know wherever there's a Roman camp, where there is an army camp, so to speak, wherever there's an army camp, you're going to have a lot of prostitution and you're going to have a lot of gambling. So this was a place that people didn't want to associate themselves with. But here we see the Lord Jesus Christ, he wasn't afraid to go to Samaria where the rejected people were living. And he wasn't afraid to go through Galilee where the Romans had their army camp and all of the different prostitution and gambling was going on. The Lord Jesus Christ wanted to give the message to these people one last time. And I want us to know, we are going to have one last time to receive the message of salvation. And brethren, when that time comes, nobody can change it. When our number comes, glory be to God, if you are not right with God, if you don't make your salvation secure, amen. Glory be to God. If you don't answer the call, when the Lord calls, when Yeshua calls you, when the message of salvation is proclaimed, and the Spirit of God moves upon your heart, and you come face to face with your sins, and the Bible tells us if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of all our sins, and to cleanse us away from all unrighteousness. If a person don't repent of their sins, and their time come, when their time come to die, brethren, there is no time for repentance in the grave. I want to let you know nobody can pray you from hell or from purgatory into heaven. The priest can't do it. Your praying grandmother and your praying aunt and your praying grandfather can't pray you into heaven. Every person has to make their calling and election sure. The Bible said this is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. Today, if you shall hear his voice, harden not your heart. Yeshua continued on his journey and he's going up to Jerusalem. And the purpose of going to Jerusalem is that he's going to die on the cross of Calvary. He's going to sacrifice his life for the sins of the whole world. And we continue in verse 12. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And here we see that there were 10 lepers, and these 10 lepers, they were living in a village, because in Old Testament time, in Bible time, when you have leprosy, you have to stay by yourself. When the nation of Israel was going from Egypt to Canaan, to the promised land, if somebody developed leprosy, they have to stay outside the camp. And here we see that these are 10 men that verse 12 is telling us here. These 12, 10 men, they had full-blown leprosy. And because they have full-blown leprosy, they have to stay by themselves. Now, in Bible time, when you have leprosy, you have to disassociate yourself from your family, from your wife, from your children, from all your community, and you have to go and live by yourself. Now, what the Bible tells us in Leviticus chapter 13, when somebody develops leprosy, you know, you have a spot on your skin, and it starts to rise, it starts to swell, and that spot, it turns to white, and, you know, it starts to, you know, become scaly, and it starts to, you know, infest, and the infestation of that sore on your skin goes below your skin. It starts to get deep. You have to go to the priest. All of this is recorded in Leviticus chapter 13. You have to go to the priest, and the priest is going to examine you, because the priest was the medical officer of health. And you have to go to the priest and you have to show him the infection that you have on your body. And if this infection is whitish, and this infection, you know, it starts to decay and going below the skin, and one of the things that the Leviticus tells us is that the hair around the infection start to become white, the priest is going to take a look at it. And if the infection it's whitish on the skin, and the hair around it is white, and it starts to decay and going below the skin, that is a case of leprosy. And the priest is going to send you outside the camp, or like these men here were sent to a special village. But then if you have an infection and you go to the priest, and the priest look at it and notice that, you know, it's not really whitish, and the hair around it is not whitish, but he's still not sure whether or not it was leprosy. What the priest was commanded to do, he had to put you away, lock you away for 7 days. And then after 7 days, the priest is going to come back and he's going to re-examine you. And if he noticed that there is no appearance of healing, you're not getting better, but he's still not sure whether or not this thing is leprosy, he's going to lock you away again for another 7 days. And then at the end of that 7 days, he will examine you, and if the sore starts to heal up and it changed from white to blackish color, because that is what leprosy was described to be, is when your whole body turned white. That is the description of leprosy. Somebody have leprosy, full-blown leprosy, their whole body will turn white. So if this sore on your skin, it changed from white to black, and you know it's a sign that you are being healed. And what the priest is going to do is going to declare you as being cleansed from that leprosy. But if that sore deteriorates, and it starts to spread all over your body, and your whole body become white. You ever see somebody that had leprosy? Some person who have full grown leprosy, their body will turn white, their skin will deteriorate, and their body turn white. You find that there will be places of their body that will start to become infected. For instance, like your ears will become infected. It's like your nose will become infected. Your fingers will become infected. Your toes will become infected. And these body parts will start to deteriorate, and they will start to sometimes fall off. Sometimes the person with leprosy, they will be sleeping at night, and maybe a mice or, you know, some insect or some kind of a, you know, roach or rat or whatever come in, because when you have leprosy, you're going to lose sensitivity in your body. And when you lose sensitivity in your body, you might be sleeping and, you know, a mice, you know, come in and they want something to eat, and they start nibbling on your toe or on your nose or on your ears or your finger. You know, you won't know anything until you get up in the morning and you discover maybe a part of your nose is gone, or a part of your ears is gone, or a part of your finger is gone. That was what it is when a person become leprous. So when you go to the priest and the priest examine you, if the priest discover that sore deteriorate to the point where he described what I just described, and it is considered to be leprous, they're going to put you away by yourself, and you have to disassociate yourself from your wife, from your husband, from your children, and you have to live in a leper community, a community or village where people with leprosy was living. So what we are seeing here is that these 10 men, they were declared to be leprous, and these 10 men was living in a village. And what I'm seeing here is that Yeshua wasn't afraid. He wasn't afraid. I think this was not an accident. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, and he knew exactly where these rejects was. These were people who society reject, and society didn't want to have anything to do with them. Because we're supposed to have leprosy. When the priests declare somebody to have leprosy, they have to live by themselves, and they have to, tear their clothes. They have to wear, you know, old raggedy kind of clothes, and they have to get something and cover their lips. They have to cover their top lip. And when they see somebody afar off approaching them, they have to call out to that person, unclean, unclean. And as you hear that word unclean, you need to take cover, you have to run away. Unclean, it means to get away from me. You know, I don't want to contaminate anybody. So anybody with leprosy, they have to stand afar off. And when they see anybody approaching, they have to call out, unclean, unclean. And here these men, they were living in a village by themselves. They have to stay in a community by themselves, because they don't want to infect anybody with this disease, because this disease was catching, and there was no cure for this disease. Amen. And the Bible tells us that Yeshua entered into a certain village. There met him 10 men that was leper, which stood afar off. So they were lepers, and they have to stand afar off. They can't come close to nobody. And they saw Jesus, but they were, you know, staying their distance away from him. They wasn't getting close to him. Glory to God. Because they know the law. If they broke the law and they come too close to any community where clean people who don't have leprosy living, they will face certain consequences. So they don't want to break the law, and these people are obeying the law. So they stay a distance away from Yeshua. And the scripture tells us in verse 13, and they lifted up their voices, amen, and said, Yeshua, yes. Hallelujah, yes. Master, yes. Have mercy on us. Glory be to God. These men, they have a need. They have a need to be cleansed. They have a need to be delivered from leprosy. Glory to God. There was no kind of a medicine back in that time to treat leprosy. In our time, leprosy, I think they call it a different name. It's called Hansen disease. And it said that they have different ways that they can treat leprosy. But back in Bible time, there was no cure for leprosy. And there's something else that there's no cure for. Anybody know? There's other things that there were no cure for it. We have sin. There's no cure for sin. There's only one cure. There's only one cure that we have for sin. There is no medicine. There is no medicine that you can use to treat sin. It is only the blood of Jesus Christ. It is only the blood of Yeshua. Amen. That can purge your sin. What can make me white as snow? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Glory be to God. Come on, let us reason together, said the Lord. Though your sin be as scarlet, it shall be as wool. Though it be red as crimson, it shall be as white as snow. It is nothing but the blood of Jesus. And here we see that these men, they probably, I don't know how the message get to them, that Yeshua was fasting in that area. But, you know, Yeshua make it his business. He make it his business to go close to that village, to pass into that village, because it's like he made an appointment to see these men. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what valley you might be in. It doesn't matter what pit you might be living in. It doesn't matter, you know, how far you might be, how far out in sin you might be. Yeshua can still reach you. Glory to God. The Lord's hand is not sharp that he cannot save. His ear is not heavy that he cannot hear. But the Bible said, our iniquity has separated us from our God. Glory to God. Our sins made a separation or a barrier between us and our God. But it's only one person who can break down that barrier. It is only one man that can destroy that barrier. The barrier, the separation that separates us from God, it is the Lord, Yeshua. Amen. The Most High God can break down the barrier. And here we see the barrier that was there between God and between these men and the community. Yeshua is going to break it down. Glory to God. They stood afar off and they lifted up their voice and said, Yeshua, Master, have mercy on us. And when they cry out for mercy, they are crying out for compassion. Have compassion on us. Do you need mercy today? Do you need mercy today? Amen. God is full of mercy. He is a merciful God. He's a loving God. He's a compassionate God. It doesn't matter what you might be facing in your life today. God is a God of mercy. God will have mercy on us. Amen. Mercy is something that we don't deserve. That is the impartation of mercy. Mercy is when God gave us something that we don't deserve. In other words, we all deserve to go to hell. We all deserve to end up in the lake of fire. But, you know, the Almighty God, the Most High God, he extend his mercy towards us. And he saved us by the washing of water and regeneration of the Holy Spirit. Oh, glory be to God. It tells us. And, you know, in verse 14, and when he saw him, and when Yeshua saw them, he said to them, go show yourself to the priest. Amen. Go show yourself to the priest. This goes right back to what I was saying in Old Testament time. When a person have leprosy, or somebody have a boil or swelling on their skin that look kind of suspicious, they have to go and show themselves to the priest, because the priest, he was the medical examiner. He was the person who examined people, because Leviticus chapter 13 tells what, you know, how to identify somebody with leprosy. So here, Yeshua just said to these men, go and show yourself to the priest. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I like how he, you know, he put it. Go and show yourself to the priest. You know who is the priest? You know he's our high priest today? Yeshua is both king. Amen. He is our high priest. Glory to God. He is the king profession of our faith. Glory to God. He's saying here, go and show yourself to the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. Glory be to God. They're on their way to see the priest. Jesus, Yeshua didn't touch them. But as they head out to see the priest, they were obedient. Amen. Amen. The Bible tells us that disobedience is worse than the sin of witchcraft. But these men didn't question Jesus. Jesus didn't question them either. He didn't say, which synagogue you attend? And Jesus didn't say to them, how much faith you have? Or how much tithes you give? How much offering you give to the temple? Jesus, all Yeshua said to them is that, go and show yourself to the priest. Brethren, obedience is very important. It is very important for us to obey the word of God. Amen. To obey is better than sacrifice. Glory to God. Obeying God is better than sacrifice. And a lot of people today have a problem with obeying God. Glory be to God. We must obey the word of God. We have to follow the principles of the word of God. And Jesus, he was the word. When he was here on earth, the word of God became flesh and tabernacle among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten Son of God, full of grace and truth. So as these men obeyed Yeshua, they head out to see the priest. The Bible said, because of their obedience, they were cleansed. He didn't touch them. He didn't pray for them. He just said, go and show yourself to the priest. And their obedience was the result of their healing. And it tells us in verse 15, and one of them, somebody say one of them. One of them. Are you one of them? One of them, when he saw that he was healed. So they're heading out to see the priest. And, you know, they suddenly became cleansed. Their leprosy disappeared. But the Bible said one of them, he examined himself. He looked on his hand. He looked at his fingers. He looked, you know, and he feel his face. And he probably feel that his nose is restored. He probably hold on to his ears. And he could feel that, you know, he had an air that is healed, that is, you know, a sound air. And he probably maybe looked under his toes because you can't wear shoes. When you have leprosy and leprosy start working on your toes, you can't put that in a shoe. So he looked down and he noticed that, you know, his toes are healed. His toes are restored. And he noticed that his fingers are restored. Glory be to God. He's examining himself. Glory, hallelujah. How much we need to examine ourselves. Amen. We need to look and see where we came from. Amen. We need to look and see where Yeshua took us from. Yes, you remember where God took you from? Yes, you remember where you are today? Hallelujah. Do you know where you are today? You know where you came from? My Jesus, look where you took me from. Amen. We have to remember where God in his goodness and his love and his mercy, he take us from. He lift me up from the miry clay. He plant my feet upon the rock to sing. He put a song within my soul to sing. Songs of praises. Hallelujah. This, the Bible said, glory be to God, I'm one of them. When he saw that he was healed, he turned back. It takes some effort, you know, to turn back. He was supposed to go and see the priest. But he turned around. Amen. He is going to give thanks to Yeshua. This is a grateful man. Glory, hallelujah. He turned around. And with a loud voice, glorify God. Hallelujah. He started to glorify God. Glory, hallelujah. You notice how quiet we are in church today? You notice how all of a sudden we become so dignified in churches today. Most churches you go, people just become so sanctimonious. And they become so dignified. They sing, they hardly want to open their mouth. People don't even want to clap their hands. But this is not the time for us to become dignified and sanctimonious. Amen. I want to say to you today, we are Hebrew Israelite people.
Amen.
Hebrew Israelite people is not quiet people. Glory, hallelujah. We need to shake off that sanctimonious, that, you know, dignified. because of the fact that, they said that Canadians are quiet. Everybody just speak right in. You don't need to be quiet. Shake away that quietness. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That quietness that we have in the body of Christ today, that kind of a dignified way that we have in praising God and worshiping God, sanctimonious kind of way that we praise God, we need to throw that away. And just like this man that was cleansed, glory, hallelujah, this man that was cleansed, hallelujah, the Bible said he started to glorify God with a loud voice. Somebody said, well, Pastor Duncan, I never have leprosy. I don't have nothing to praise God for. That's what somebody would say. I don't have nothing to praise God for, so why am I going to be loved? I want to let you know today that you have something that is worse than leprosy. You have something that is worse than leprosy, and that is sin. And Yeshua delivered us from sin. And there should not be a time when we as God's people, we should not find time to praise God and to worship God and to lift up our hands. The Bible talks about lifting up holy hands. Is your hand holy? You have holy hands. Lift up holy hands. Amen. We need to lift up holy hands. Glory to God. When you lift up your hands, you know what you're saying. When you lift up your hands, anybody know what you're saying? You lift up your both hands in the air. Lift your both hands in the air. What you're saying? You surrender. Glory, hallelujah. You are saying that you surrender. Lifting up holy hands. I surrender. Amen. You surrender to the Most High God. And it tells us that this man, he glorified God with a loud voice. He praised God. He put some energy. That's what I'm saying, man. When you're up here in the worship team, you have to put some energy. You have to put some energy into it. If you're up here and you're leading the worship and you're not putting any more energy into it, the people that are down there, they're not going to put no energy into it. That's the reason why when I come to church, I'm going to put energy in whatever I'm doing. If I'm going to sing, I'm going to sing with energy. If I'm going to preach, I'm going to preach with energy. If I'm going to walk down here, I'm going to walk down here with energy. Because I have life in me. Glory to God, I'm alive. Glory, hallelujah. Brethren, this is not a time for us to act like dead men and dead women in the church of God, in the house of God. We have to act as if we have life within us. Act lively. Praise God, hallelujah. This man, he have life in him, and he start to glorify God. Praise the name of the Lord. In verse 16, so he turned around. Remember, he was on his way to see the priest, and he turned around and he fell down on his face at his feet, at Yeshua's feet. And this is what he said, giving thanks. He fell down at Yeshua's feet. In other words, when he cried out to God, when he gave God thanks, he was referring to Yeshua. Yes. And a lot of people is saying that Jesus or Yeshua is not God. Jesus is as much God as Yahweh is God or the Holy Spirit is God. And this man fell down at Yeshua's feet and he worshiped him. If Yeshua was not God, Yeshua would be committing blasphemy when he allowed this man to fall down at his feet and worship him. If Yeshua was not God, Yeshua was supposed to pick this man up and say, you're not supposed to worship me, man. It's the Most High that give you healing. Don't worship me. And Yeshua didn't do that. But he didn't receive the worship. And you know, there are references in the Old Testament when an angel will appear to a human person, and the human person will fall down on their face before the angel and start to worship the angel. Angel don't receive worship. The angel will say, stand up, man. But when you see somebody appear, when you see an Old Testament appearance of Yeshua, amen, they call it a theophany. When you see a theophany, an Old Testament appearance of Yeshua, and somebody fall down and start to worship, he appeared like an angel, but he's not an angel, and he accept the worship. Son of the living God. It is Yeshua. It is he who appeared in an Old Testament theophany and received worship. So here we see that Yeshua, this man fell down on his face before Yeshua and he gave him thanks. Hallelujah. He praised him, he worshiped him, and he was a Samaritan. He was a reject. So here we get into some history. Amen. Pastor Duncan is going to put on his historian cap. Amen. We are going to talk about some history. When you talk about the Samaritan, were rejected. There were a class of people that was considered to be dogs. When you're dealing with the Jews, the Jewish people considered them to be dogs because they were half-breed. Now, how did it come about? Now, after the death of King Solomon, Solomon's son, Jeroboam, he took over leadership. And there was a controversy between Rehoboam. Rehoboam was a servant of Solomon, but he was an influential man. And there was some kind of controversy where leadership is concerned between Jeroboam, which was Solomon's son, and Rehoboam, who was a servant. And this guy, Rehoboam, he had a lot of influence with the people, with the nation of Israel. Because back in that time, Solomon's son, he was overtaxing the people. So the people more or less revolt against him. And, Jeroboam took away 10 tribes from King Solomon's son. And that is when we have the division of the kingdom. You ever hear about the division of the kingdom? The nation of Israel was divided. And the kingdom split up. And we have 10 of the tribes that decided that they were split away. And they were at the north. And they call themselves Israel. And from that, they have their capital city that was set up. They call it Samaria. And then we have two of the tribe, which was Judea. Or in that time, it didn't have Judea. It was Yehuda. Because there was no J back in that time. Because the letter J, as like we were talking this morning, the letter J was invented or came into being maybe 400 years ago. So there was no Judea, there was no Jerusalem, there were no Jews because there were no letter J. So to cut the chart, Yehuda and Benjamin, they were the two tribes that stayed to the south, and they have their capital. Their capital was Jerusalem. So here we see there's a separation or a division in the kingdom, and this lasts for 254 years. And after 254 years, in 721 BC, we have the Assyrian. The Assyrian Empire came in from Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia, where Abraham came from. The Assyrian Empire came in 721 BC. And what they did, they invaded the northern kingdom, the 10 tribes of Israel. And what they did, they took thousands of people from the northern kingdom. Hebrew Israelite people, they take them and they deport them and they send them in areas where the Assyrian Empire was controlling. And what they did, they brought in people from other areas where the Assyrian Empire was controlling, and they brought them into Israel, where the 10 tribes was living. So these people from outside, these outsiders came in and they commingled with the Hebrew Israelite people, and they intermarry with them, and they produce this nation of people, or this breed of people, that we call the Samaritans. So the Samaritans, they were half-breed, and they were rejected, and the Jewish people didn't like them. And it's just like in the time of slavery. We have the mulatto. You ever hear about the mulatto? Yes. The mulatto race of people. Where do you think the mulatto race of people came from? The mulatto race of people, I'd be having a mulatto on me. I see some people that be feeling kind of uncomfortable. You're not feeling uncomfortable. Are you a mulatto? We have the mulatto. The mulatto race of people. Where did the mulatto race of people come from? They came from the black race of people. It was during the time of slavery. During the time of slavery, when the white slave master, when he raped the black Israelite woman, those young black Israelite women, slave people, the black people didn't receive them. These people were likely in a no man's land because the black race of people didn't like them, and the white race of people didn't like them. Nobody didn't receive them, and you know, they were considered like nothing. And this happened all over. And what is said, after slavery, when slavery was ended, and according to what is said, that we have more than 250,000 biracial people in the United States alone. And what they said, there was a lot of Hebrew Israelite women that was raped and they become pregnant with these children, and these children became mulatto. If you take it and you go down to Haiti, you will see that during the time when they have the uprising, when they have a slave rebellion in Haiti, you will see that the mulatto race of people, they were on the side of the Europeans. They didn't side with the slave because the Europeans was treating the mulatto, they were treating them better than the slaves, and they give them lands, so they tend to take the side of the Europeans. So what we say is that these people, they were half-breed, just like the mulatto. The mulatto race of people came up from black people. And to finish it off, every other race of people on the face of the earth, you know where they came from? You know what race of people they come from? Every other race of people on the face of the earth came up from the black race. The black woman and the black man is the father and mother of every race of people on the face of the earth. Look, it was on the news. It was on the news 2 weeks ago. There was a tribe of people up in India. I hope it's not me alone that watching the news and listening to these things. There's a tribe of people up in India. They say that they're not civilized. If anybody tried to get close to them, they will kill you. And then this Chinese guy, he said that he's going to evangelize them. So he went out there a few times, and then they catch him, I guess they kill him, I don't know if they eat him or whatever they did to him. But his body, I don't think they discovered his body as yet. But my point is that way up in India, you have black people living. And we have to understand, in olden time, Africa, or what we talk about, Negro land, it runs all the way from Africa. It goes all the way. Africa used to go all the way up to India and China. Why do you think we have black people still living up in up in India? It's because Negro land, or what we call Africa, go all the way up there. And what we call the Middle East is a recent thing. You know when the Middle East came into existence? The Middle East came into existence in 1902. Before 1902, what we call the Middle East today, where Israel is today, and they say the Middle East, there was no such thing as the Middle East. Go and look up a map of Negro land, and you'll see all of those places used to be where Africa used to extend and still extend. Glory to God. So getting back to what we are saying, this is how the Samaritan came into existence. The Samaritans, they were half-breed people. And the Jewish people, the Hebrew Israelite people, didn't like them because they came out from other race of people. They were mixed-breed kind of people. And they see them as nothing. So this one person, this one man that was healed and turned around, looked at himself and see that his body was restored, and he decided he's going to go back to give thanks. He was a Samaritan. He was somebody who was rejected. He was somebody who was considered to be a stranger. A stranger turned around, and he was grateful to Yeshua, to the Most High. He turned around, and he went back and he gave thanks. In verse 17, and Yeshua answering said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Glory be to God. Hallelujah. How many people God has been good to? Amen. God is good to the whole world. And how many people today is giving thanks to God? Less than 1% is giving thanks to God. We see that there were 10 cleansed. But how much return? Only one. It's only the 1%. 1% went back. Glory be to God. Amen. Not less than 1% of the people of the world today is grateful to God, even in the church today. Look how many people we have that, you know, came out from the Caribbean island. We were talking about the Caribbean island. Came out from the islands. People, thousands upon thousands of people, born again people that came out from the Caribbean islands. And they come here to Canada, come here in, go to the United States. How many of them do you think still go to church? How many of them do you think still turning around and giving thanks to God? Amen. They came in here as foreigners. We came in as foreigners, and the Lord helped us out. The Lord deliver us. Amen. Now we become Canadian, and now we become U.S. citizen. We don't want Yeshua anymore. We don't have time for God. Amen. We're not foreigners anymore. We're not strangers anymore. We mix in. Glory, hallelujah. You remember when people was back home and they are grateful to God and they're serving the Lord, and you know, even though they don't have food to eat, they're still giving thanks to God. I know you're here in a place where you have lots of food and people still are grateful to God. Jesus said, go there not 9 cleansed, 10 cleansed. He said 10 of them were cleansed. Where are the 9? The other 9. Amen. In verse 17, as we close, and Yeshua answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Only one returned. Glory be to God. And as I close, it said, and he said, they were not found, he said in verse 18, they were not found that returned to give glory to God except this stranger. It's only the stranger that came back in. And the stranger is the Samaritan. And the nine what that was ungrateful, they were full-blooded Hebrew Israelite people. The Hebrew Israelite people didn't turn around and give thanks to God. They were ungrateful. And what we have seen happening today is that Hebrew Israelite people, anybody know who's Hebrew Israelite people? I'm talking about the black race of people that came out that was kidnapped. That was kidnapped by Europeans and brought over into this part of the world. That is where the true Hebrew Israelite people is from. And what I'm seeing is that we are becoming ungrateful. Especially those who are highly educated. You see these highly educated men and women that, you know, some of them are professors and some of them they are historian and all of that. And these men are philosophers and they're highly educated, and because of the fact that they know a lot of history, and they will dig up the history of Kemet, which was the original name of Egypt, dig up the history of Egypt and Ethiopia and Africa and, you know, all of these places, Nubia, dig up all of these history, and their head is full with these history, black history. And what they're doing, these educated men, what they're doing, they are turning away from the God of the Bible. All of these men that have all of these knowledge about black history, they don't want to hear nothing or have anything to do with the God of the Bible. And what they're getting into now is ancestors worship. They're worshiping their ancestors. Listen, man, I am grateful for all of our ancestors, from Adam right down to all of our ancestors that was in the time of slavery. I am grateful to them, but I'm not going to worship none of them. There's only one person that deserves worship. It is Yeshua. Glory to God. It is the Most High God. Amen. The Bible tells us, at the name of Yeshua, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Yeshua is God, to the glory and to the honor of Almighty God the Father. So we need to be grateful. We have to turn around and give thanks. It doesn't matter what situation you might be in. We still need to be grateful to God. Bless the name of the Lord. Jesus said, it is only the stranger, the Samaritan, the half-breed, the foreigner, the one who wasn't, he wasn't belong. They didn't accept him. He is the only one that turned around and give thanks to God. What a shame, amen, upon the Israelite community when we are rejecting the God of the Bible and we start to look for different strange God that came up from Egypt. The God of Egypt, all of these different gods, and I don't really remember some of their names. I'm also interested in retaining some of these names because they're not true gods. And these men worshiping these gods of Egypt and worshiping ancestors and turning away from the God of the Bible. But brethren, we have to be careful. Amen. We have to be careful who we are going to patronize or who we're going to follow. Amen. We need to follow Christ. Follow the anointed one. Praise the name of the Lord. And as I close, it tells us in verse 19, and he said to him, arise, go your way. Get up. It's time for you to get up. He was on his face before Yeshua. Yeshua said to him, arise, get busy, go out and spread the word. Go your way. Your faith has made you whole. Our Paul said on this, your faith has made you whole. Now, let me explain this. When the Bible says your faith has made you whole, it doesn't mean that the faith that you have helped God to achieve your deliverance. It doesn't matter how much faith we have. Our faith don't help God to do nothing. What our faith will do for us, our faith helps us to receive from God. But your faith don't help God. Whether you have faith or you don't have faith, if God wants to show you favor, it doesn't matter if you have faith or you don't have faith. God is going to choose to heal or to deliver you in whatever condition you are. But the thing is, if we have faith, our faith will help us to receive from God. The Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By these, the elders obtain a good report. Let us continue to serve the Lord and trust Him, keeping our eyes upon Him. I'm going to ask the musicians to come back. Praise the name of the Lord. We will prepare to sing a song. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. We will sing a song. I know whom I believe, and I'm persuaded that He is able.